What's up, y'all? Happy Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month. We at Bitch Talk are celebrating all things Asian, and we wanted to kick back this episode with Lisa Ling, who is one of our heroes. It was a really exciting, fun interview. You guys give it another listen. And don't forget that her show, Take Out with Lisa Ling, is streaming right now on HBO and Apple Plus. So enjoy this interview and happy AAPI Heritage Month.
Welcome to Bitch Talk, booze interviews straight from the heart of San Francisco. I'm Erin. That's Ange.
Hi.
That's Char.
Hello.
You can find us at bitchtalkpodcast.com where you can sign up for our monthly e-news.
For behind-the-scenes videos and two-minute clips of our interviews, head to our YouTube channel and subscribe.
You can find us every other Thursday morning at 9:30 a.m. at BFF.fm.
And if you like what you hear, rate and subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts. For the love of God, do it. It really helps.
Bitch Talk in the house.
Oh, Lisa Ling in the house.
Lisa Ling in the house.
Should we just start singing karaoke just to get, you know, get us warmed up?
There's a reason why you didn't actually hear me singing karaoke on our...
I was going to say...
That was going to be a question.
Where was that
later.
Audio?
Let's save that. Let's put it in the back pocket. That's going to come. Okay. We are so excited to bring you American journalist, TV personality, author, personal hero, Lisa Ling, to talk about HBO's new six-part documentary series, Takeout. Thank you so much for being here, Lisa.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm with the bitches.
Official bitch, exactly.
Where I belong.
Now you're official. Now,
exactly.
Well,
can you start by introducing Takeout to our audience?
Absolutely. So the way I describe our show, Takeout, is it's an exploration of buried Asian American histories through the lens of food that Americans have come to love and that has become the most ubiquitous kind of food in this country.
It is so much fun to watch. Six episodes is not enough. I was texting Erin after every episode, but we're going to get to that later. First, I just have to say that 14-year-old me that was watching you on Channel One in high school is just bursting with pride and joy right now. I feel like instead of interviewing you, I should be asking you how to interview you. Just you're the boss. But I want to start with, you actually left USC before graduating because you wanted to travel the world. And you knew at that early age that that was going to be the best education for you. So I'm interested to know, where did you travel at that young age, and how did it inform the type of journalist that you were to become?
I know, what a disgraceful Asian, right?
I was going to ask, how did the family feel about that?
I can relate.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be totally honest with you. You know, another way I went against stereotype is I struggled in school. I had ADD. And really had a hard time being confined within the walls of a classroom. And so when I started working for Channel One News, I got the job when I was 18. It was a show that was seen in schools across the country. It was a news broadcast. And I was initially hired to be one of their young, kind of cute-ish, you know, correspondents. Like it was, what, you know, God, 35 years ago when I was doing this. It wasn't until I started traveling and the show sent me all over the world to cover stories that I just became this sponge that just wanted to absorb everything that I was seeing and I was observing and learning. I mean, the world became my classroom so profoundly. My senses were heightened, my eyes were opened, and I would go back to my classes at USC and tell the professor, my Russian studies professor, that I just, I covered the Russian referendum elections. And so, you know, it became for me, not just dropping out of a university, it was really just extending my education outside of the classroom. And so I would never encourage people to drop out of school because I do find tremendous value in a college education. But for me, I had an opportunity to continue my learning in a much more tactile way. And that has led me to this path now.
Throughout Takeout, and like to Ange's point, at episode 6, I'm like, oh, okay, what's the next food? What's the next area we're going to cover? And it was over. So I'm really hoping there's a season 2. But throughout Takeout, you talk about growing up in the Sacramento area, Carmichael. We're in the Bay Area, so definitely know the area. And it's a story that weaves throughout the series. Can you talk about growing up there and how you really wanted to bust out and how it felt during that time to be probably one of the only Asians in school?
Yeah, there were so few Asians in my middle and high school and even elementary school. And I hated being Asian because I was different. Look, I had a lot of friends. I was a fairly popular kid, but I was teased all the time. And when you are in middle school and high school, all you want to do is fit in. You don't want to give people a reason to make fun of you. And I had a big reason that I couldn't change, and that was that I was Asian. And so when I was 17, I wanted to get out of there because I just felt so stifled. And I moved to Los Angeles to live with my mom and start USC. And this whole world opened up to me of diversity in LA. And it was after I left Carmichael that I really decided to try and get in touch with my roots. Now, the reality is that Sacramento itself has always been very diverse, and there's always been a thriving Asian community, particularly Chinese, and that the roots of the Chinese community there run very, very deep. But because I was in Carmichael and my parents didn't really talk to me much about Asian American history, and I never learned anything about Asian American history in school, for me, I always just wanted to distance myself from that thing that made me different. And really, it wasn't until I went back there and shot an episode of Takeout that I really got in touch with the Chinese American roots in my hometown. You know, I visited this town called Lok that is still standing, that was developed in the early 1900s. And after the Chinese built the transcontinental railroads, there was this push to get the Chinese out of cities. Chinatowns throughout the West Coast were being burnt to the ground. Chinese people were getting lynched and harassed and tortured. And so an enterprising group of Chinese people from the Guangdong province, the Zhongshan people, they negotiated with white landowners to clear these pear orchards, and they built this town for themselves. And it wasn't a Chinatown that was attached to a city. It was its own independent town. And at any time, that town could have been, you know, taken away from them because they could only negotiate for a lease that was month to month because the white landowners didn't want to extend those leases. But they built a life for themselves there. And for me to actually go to that town and stand in the places where this community that was so discriminated against and scapegoated, they sought refuge in this town. It was so moving. And it was the first time in 47 years that I felt connected to my Chinese roots in my hometown.
Yeah, that episode was so emotional. And you really have worked with everyone at this point. I mean, you were on The View, National Geographic, CNN, Oprah. I mean, we'd like her contact, by the way. But throughout everything that you've worked on, it feels like we just get a little bit closer to the real Lisa Ling. And we watch you sort of come to terms with that, especially in episode 2 that Aaron was referencing. So what did it feel like for you to go there emotionally on camera as it's happening in real time?
Yeah, you know, I've gotten pretty decent at telling other people's stories. But this was really this journey to look into not only my roots, but also to kind of dig into why I felt so much shame around my ethnicity. And I think it's a kind of shame that so many of us Asian Americans have felt throughout our lives. Because when our histories aren't told, right, when there's no reference to our community's inclusion in our history books, it's so easy to overlook an entire community and to even dehumanize it, right? And so my objective growing up was always like white adjacency. You know, what can I do to be seen as more white? Because those are, you know, the people who are controlling everything, right? Who are controlling the narrative. And so the last few years have really been, I think, a period of reckoning for the whole, for our whole community. You know, I mean, when attacks on Asian people in the wake of COVID started to happen, I think so many people were shocked. How could this be happening to our community? Well, when you look, when you actually do some digging and you look into the history of Asians in America, you see that this just is, it's a continuous pattern of scapegoating that Asians have been on the receiving end of since Asian people first arrived in this country. But because our stories aren't told, it comes as a surprise. And so for me, this opportunity to do this series, first of all, it's something I never even dreamt of. I couldn't have possibly dreamt that one day I would be able to celebrate Asian American stories and Asian American food, you know, food that I was also so ashamed of. But it's this precious time where this door is open and people want to know. And that's really exciting, you know, that my kids actually are growing up in a different world where the stories of people who look like her are finally not only getting told, but they're getting celebrated. And it's just, you know, it's awesome to be alive, to be able to experience this. And then to hear the response. I mean, I've been working in this business for almost 35 years. And for so many Asian Americans to say, I feel seen, you know, like sharing this story, watching Asian American stories, because again, Asian America is very different from Asia. And so our, you know, our demographic is in and of itself a unique category. You and I, Angela, what kind of Asian are you? Filipino?
Filipino, episode one. Yeah.
Okay.
No big deal.
But you and I have more in common with each other than you have with people who are living in the Philippines today, or that I have with people who are living in China. Asian Americans, wherever, you know, irrespective of where our ancestors come from, we are our own category. And so I hope that Asian Americans feel a kind of ownership over all of these stories. And even non-Asian Americans, these are American stories at the end of the day. You know, they belong to all of us.
I wanted to ask, was this show born out of the pandemic? And also, how did you land on the stories? Because now I know a lot of shit about Bangladeshi food. So
mm-hmm. Correct.
Loved that opening, by the way. Loved it.
Thank you. It's fun to work for streamers where you can, you know, you can speak the way you speak.
And yep. Yep.
So we got this series approved or greenlit in the beginning of the pandemic, but before all of the Asian hate. Mm. And I actually was shocked that this, my team and I pitched about 10 different ideas to HBO Max, and the one they chose was takeout. And I just thought, wow, I do you think that there will be an audience? Do you think people really want to know these stories? I mean, it was just a different kind of like thought process, right? And headspace that I'd ever occupied. And they greenlit it. And after they did, I said, well, I need at least 20 episodes. Because yeah. It's such a diverse.
Exactly.
Maybe six. And how do we choose the six? I mean, we still have this long list, so I'm praying that we get another season. But I think that we chose stories that even Asian Americans might have not been aware of otherwise. I mean, I do think now that most people know that Filipinos were the first Asians to land in America, but I don't know that most know that they landed not on the West Coast or the East Coast, but in the bayous of Louisiana. And so, you know, that was such a, you know, for me also, this has been such an incredible education. You know, I mean, these are stories that were not included in my history books. And so I am learning along with everyone else. And it's been so fascinating and such a joy. The episode that we did on Boyle Heights, you would never think about Boyle Heights as an Asian community because now it's mostly Latino and proudly Latino. And I was shocked. It was my Mexican-American friend, Rolando Cruz, after he read about takeout, he said, oh, you should come to the only Japanese restaurant left in Boyle Heights. I said, only restaurant left? Left from what? mm-hmm. And I would go on to learn that after World War II, after Japanese-Americans were released from prison camps, Boyle Heights was one of the only places they could afford to live because they lost everything. They lost their businesses and their homes. And so in the wake of the end of World War II, there was a thriving Japanese American community in Boyle Heights. And Boyle Heights, you know, to this day has just become this incredible refuge for immigrant communities. And there's still these beautiful and incredible vestiges of that Japanese American community left in Boyle Heights. And the restaurant, the one Japanese restaurant left, interestingly enough, has really become, you know, a staple of the community. It's so embraced by its mostly Latino community. And they call the owner of that restaurant their Japanese mom. And so it's just like this beautiful blending of immigrant stories and American stories in this, you know, little enclave called Boyle Heights.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I love, this is the last time I bring up episode one, but I just have to say, when I first saw that it was called Mix Mix, I was like, is this going to be Filipino? And it was because of the highly undervalued dessert, halo halo.
Highly undervalued. I fantasize about that.
It's
about
so halo delicious. Halo. Yeah. And I loved it because obviously I just had so much pride, much more pride in Filipino culture and history here than I ever did before. But also I'm going to have to read my notes here. I wrote, Lisa Ling said, fuck you. And so that made me just extremely happy. But I want to talk about how you share the successes, not just the struggles of these cultures. And especially as children of immigrants, how our parents fought just to exist here. But now you're showing how the children of these immigrants are fighting to make sure that workers' rights and human rights are never devalued again. And it doesn't have to be a protester with a sign. It can be someone that running a restaurant that is also instilling these things.
Well, you know, Angela, it's a great point that you're making. And that's why, to me, there's this urgency. There's an urgency attached to this series. I mean, we know that our elders have borne the brunt of so many of these attacks in recent years. And our elders are the ones who made those extraordinary sacrifices to leave everything that they knew in their home country to come and try to eke out some semblance of the American dream here. And it's for them that this is urgent. You know, it's for them that our generation has to loudly proclaim our belonging, you know, in this country, because our relatives and our grandparents and our great grandparents, you know, they this is why they made those sacrifices, for us not to stand idly by, but to assert our voices and to assert our belonging. And so for me, that's always in the back of my mind now when I am talking about this series, that the immigrant story is the American story. You know, no matter where you're from, you know, every person in this country, our ancestors came from somewhere else. You know, but ours is the one demographic whose story really just hasn't been told. And so therefore, it's really easy to characterize people who look like us as not being from here, you know, as being foreigners. And it's time that our generation, I mean, you and I are different generations, you're younger than me, but collectively, our generations have to stake our claim in this country. You know, it's incumbent upon us to do that.
And that leads into my question. How do we make this moment last? You know, Ange and I had a conversation late the other night saying like, oh, it's finally cool to be Asian. We have to like claim this moment, right? But we need to make it forever now. So in your opinion, how do we do that?
Well, I think the next evolution of this really is, yes, it's cool to be Asian, but it's even cooler to hold the hands of all of those around us. You know what I mean? To not remain, you know, segregated in some ways. You know, now that like, for so long, Asian Americans were segregated, right? The Filipinos, like, you know, they became part of Filipino events, and Chinese became part of like Chinese events and so on. And I think what COVID has taught us is that perpetrators don't discriminate, right? They'll attack anyone who looks Asian. And so for us, it's this realization of our shared cultures, right? And our shared Asian American-ness. But now it's also time for us to do what we can to never be silent about marginalized communities anywhere, anyhow, anytime. You know, I mean, I think that, you know, that is our ancestors came here to have a better life and to provide better lives for their offspring and their progeny thereafter, right? But it's our job as Americans, you know, to try and ensure that for all people, right? Not just our own people. And so that's what I hope becomes the next evolution, that at a certain point, we will recognize that these stories are all of our stories, right? The stories of Black America, those are all of our stories. The stories of Latin America, those are all of our stories, you know? And you know, I think that this is just providing this opening, you know, where we're just constantly evolving. And that is my hope. And it's something that I hope that within my lifetime, I'll be able to experience like that true meaning of inclusivity.
Yes, well, Lisa, sadly, we're going to have to wrap, but really quickly before we go, what is your go-to karaoke song? I have to know.
I don't even know if you will know this song because you're younger than me, but Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton.
Of course.
Yeah, come on. Okay. We are not.
We are old.
We are not that young, Lisa. Okay. Islands, of course.
That is probably, that's one. I love a duet. I just love a duet. And you know the Ozzy Osbourne Lita Ford song, When I Close My Eyes Forever. Oh, that's a good one too.
Oh yeah. No. Okay.
Yeah that's well, the one I don't know.
Well, hopefully we can sing karaoke one day with you and then my life will be complete.
Well, I have to have many, many shots before I will engage in that.
But with kimchi backs, which is another thing I learned. Kimchi backs, that's on the list. Well, thank you so much, Lisa. This has been a true honor. Again, we've been speaking with Lisa Ling. The show is called Takeout on HBO. Watch it and eat well. We hope to see you again soon.
Thank you all so much. It was a pleasure.
If you like what you hear, rate and subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts.
For more information about us, you can head to bitchtalkpodcast.com.
This podcast is created, hosted, and executive produced by Aaron Lim.
My co-host is Angela Tabora, a.k.a. Captain Party.
The show's edited by producer Shar.
We're powered by GoTo Productions.